church and are engaged in other philanthropic services directly. It's my honor and pleasure also to introduce Raul Alvarez, who is president of the Cypress College Americana, I'm sorry, the Cypress College Foundation, of which the Americana Awards is an event. So I'd first like to ask Raul maybe just to make some comments, and then Harleen, if you could share a few words.
Thank you, Seth, and thank you. I won't repeat what Seth said, but I want to thank you for the years of support from Seal Beach. It's not something that we take for granted, so we appreciate it. Cypress College is a school of choice for over 16,000 students. And before I say a word about the Americana Awards, several months ago, Cypress College was named the number 3 community college in the state of California out of 113. And within the last year, Cypress College is one of 15 California community colleges certified by the state of California to offer a bachelor's degree. Now, the idea is not to compete with UCs in Cal States. That would be obviously redundant. But we're offering a bachelor's degree starting in 2017 in mortuary science. So one of 15 colleges. We're very proud of that. But we, every year, we recognize folks that just, it's inspiring how much time and energy and substance is devoted to making our community a better place to live. I'm a resident of Seal Beach, and I love it. I think it's particularly exciting this year, especially in the wake of the 100th anniversary of Seal Beach. We look forward to a wonderful, wonderful evening. There are no more deserving recipients, certainly. And speaking of anniversaries, in 2016-17, Cypress College will celebrate its 50th anniversary, so we're a little behind you, but we'll get there. So thank you. Congratulations to Harleen, and you just keep up the fabulous work.
I just wanted to thank Raul and Cypress College and the whole Americana Project for this honor. And I do accept it in the name of Interval House. They are the ones that deserve it, and I'm only too happy to be a spokesman for them and the fine work that they do constantly for over 35 years, and they have a strong history and connection to Seal Beach, so I'm proud to represent them in this. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and I believe Raul has some invitations to distribute via the city clerk. Raul, help me, it's the 29th. Oh, that's right.
27th.
That's right. It's a leap year, so we've got 29, right, but it is the 27th. And you can go online, Americana Awards, Cypress College. There are lots of ways that you can get more information. I hope this council and staff will be as supportive as you were when I was a recipient, which was truly a humbling honor. And it's an honor and a pleasure to have the tradition carried on. And I would say one final thing about Harleen and Barbara, that it was a unanimous vote by the committee. And thank you, Councilman Deaton, for your participation on that committee. That unanimous decision was really for the centennial, because we had both past and the future and present together in our centennial year, even though the Americana Awards was in 2016. So it was an exceptional award. And again, no more deserving people could have possibly received it. Thank you.
Thank you, Seth.
We have the Orange County Fire Authority here this evening. Would Battalion Chief Robert Acosta like to let us know what's happening?
Excuse me?
Would you like to let us know what's happening with
absolutely.
OCFA?
Mayor, Council, thank you for the opportunity to take a few moments of your time tonight. Like you said, I'm Robert Acosta, Battalion Chief for Orange County Fire, here on behalf of Ken Cruz, who had a conflict. Otherwise, he would have been here to do this short presentation for you. I'm here to talk tonight about Pulse Point, which we have a couple slides for you to go over. Orange County Fire is proud to be joining Pulse Point, along with other local agencies, to help increase public safety. Next slide. So what does Pulse Point do? Pulse Point utilizes your smartphone to alert nearby CPR-trained citizens concurrently with first responders of an emergency in the area. It'll direct citizens with a live map to the victim and the nearest AED. Go ahead. So the project goal, this is part of a grant that we had, is to increase survival rates of sudden cardiac arrest through bystander CPR. The American Heart Association tells us that more than 1,000 people a day die in the United States due to sudden cardiac arrest. In Orange County, we average 3 deaths a day due to sudden cardiac arrest. I can tell you from a firsthand account I had last week, I was having lunch with my wife. It went off, and we went into a restaurant across the street. And so I'm here, I was there along with probably 4 or 5 other off-duty firemen, police officers that had it on their phone and showed up and were able to provide safety. So it works. It definitely works. And anybody that has a smartphone can put this on their phone. It's a very good program. Next chain. So the American Heart Association has a chain of survival. There's 5 components to the chain. The very first one is early 911 access. Next is rapid CPR, external defibrillation, advanced care life support, which is the paramedics, and then definitive care in the ER. The weakest links in the chain by far are the early CPR and the AED. The American Heart Association says that CPR is initiated only 32% of the time, and the public AED that are available in most public places is only applied 4% of the time. So those are the areas that we feel that are the American Heart Association, Pulse Point, and the fire agents feel we can make the biggest difference. So we'll go to the next slide. This is what it looks like for the Pulse Point if you add it to your iPhone. It looks very similar on other smartphones. But if your phone's with you, this is your first notification you get that there's CPR needed, and it gives you the address. You open your phone, and then you get this screen up here. It'll say CPR is needed. And the 3 icons on the screen are one, the blue dots where you're at. The red heart that's broken is where CPR is needed. And then the next yellow indicator here tells you where the nearest AED is. So it's something that works. It's very rapid. When I experienced it, we were there probably about 60 seconds before the nearest first responder got there, which was police officers, and another 60 seconds before the actual ALS care got there. It's a very effective tool, and it works very well, and I'd encourage everybody here to put it on their phones. Next slide. To get started and to get it loaded up on your phone, go to the Apple Store or Google Play Store, download the Pulse Point app. It's a free app. It walks you through so you can customize your preferences. You can do just CPR events. You can do CPR, structured fires, traffic collisions, flooding. You can pick all the different type of notifications that you want to have, and it'll automatically come up on your phone. Then you can put it specific to jurisdictions because you don't necessarily want to have countywide notifications. So for this particular city, Seal Beach is in OCFA Division 1 jurisdiction, and that'll give you all the events that occur here. So you could be notified. In some events, you'll be notified of emergencies 10, 15 seconds before the fire units go, just by the way that the trickle-down works. But the guys have been keeping these on the fire station because it actually will notify them before their alarm's off, and they'll start heading to the fire engine. Very effective tool. We're very happy to be part of it. And that's the presentation. If you have any questions, you can certainly ask any one of the OCFA employees, myself, or any of my peers, or you can go to pulsepoint.org, and they have a good little video and information provided. That's it.
Thank you very much. Very informative. I hope people here take advantage of it. And can we have a winter storm update?
Yes, Mayor, thank you. As the Mayor and Council knows, a couple months ago we came to you to talk about staff's coordinated efforts in preparation for the winter storm in El Nino. And so before I turn it over to Jim Basham and Michael Ho to give an update, I'd really like to commend our public works staff's successful efforts last week in preparation and response to the storms last week. And Jim, I'll ask you and Michael just to give us an update on last week's efforts.
Thank you. Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. Before our city engineer gives you a presentation on the 2016 storm, I just want to say and just echo what the city manager has indicated. The public works staff functioned as a team. They mobilized immediately during the storm preparation last week. We even had our representative who we rented the pumps from. He was present during the times of our storm and took a look at how we were operating the generator, make sure that we was anything else that we need. So we were well prepared in that regard. We even had an incident or call from College Park East where some trash cans were floating because it happened to be a day of trash pickup, and we mobilized four public works crew members from the yard and four from City Hall. So we had eight guys that mobilized within 5 minutes to a location to retrieve trash bins. So it just demonstrates the effectiveness of team player environment that we have in this organization and our willingness to come together under these time and efforts and to do whatever we need to ensure that the residences stay safe as much as we can, keep them safe, and also the businesses and to keep them continuing their operation. So Michael is going to give you the presentation now and just give you an understanding as to what we noticed and what we were involved in last week, and it gives you more of a truer perspective of our engagement.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Michael?
Okay, thank you, Director Basham. The next following slides are some actual photos that we've taken during the actual storm. The storm event occurred back last week, Tuesday and Wednesday. A lot of these photos that you see coming up next are roughly around in the afternoon time during the large rain event that we occurred. So this first photo that you see here, this is actually in College Park East. This is on Ironwood, looking southerly or easterly. And what you see here is the curb and the gutter when in the actual rainfall event that has the water collected in the curb and gutter. As you can see that the water collected in the area, we also have black hoses that you see attached to the pump in the next photo that we'll show you in a little bit. This is the pump that it's attached to. So as the operation is going, we plan on removing some of the water, discharging it out onto Ironwood, and pass down to Candleberry. This next slide just shows more rainfall collected in the curb and gutter. And as it approaches the catch basin, this is at the intersection of Guava and Ironwood. This next slide shows more photos of College Park East. A lot of the efforts that we had was throughout the city, but a lot of our attention was taking a look in College Park East as well. Another photo on Ironwood and Guava. This photo right here, this is in Bridgeport. We took some photos during the rain event. We just wanted to capture some of the photos throughout the entire city during the actual rain event. And this one's in Bridgeport as well, near Corsair Way. And another photo in Corsair. And this one's also on Corsair as well, showing the rainfall and the collection in the curb and gutter at the catch basins. And lastly, this is over on Marina. This is another pump station location that we have. This just shows how that we plan on using the actual pumps and operations and how it discharges at this site. This one's at Marina Park, looking northerly at Carvel Way. And this last photo, I believe, was taken after midnight on Thursday. We experienced in College Park East a slight hailstorm. So this is kind of a collection of that type of hailstorm at the intersection of Astor and Basswood. And that concludes the slideshow. And for any questions?
I have a comment, Madam Mayor.
Go ahead.
I just want to let you know I went out there on Wednesday and Tuesday and Thursday morning at about 5:30 after the big hailstorm and rainstorm, and things did look like they were working for your strategy. I know you, we met and we talked extensively about the plan and how everything's working, and it seemed to work very well. In addition to that, there is a grave concern, and I think rightfully so, from the residents at Corsair, that in the past it has flooded. So they're on edge, I guess, is, you know, to put it lightly. I talked to a lot of the residents. So I assured them that you had a plan and that you're following the plan and you're going to be keeping an eye on that street and every other street, too. That's not the only low point in the city, obviously. And then I would be out there, too, as I was last week, three different occasions. But the main question I had, maybe you could just answer it briefly. I don't want to go into the whole, you know, El Nino topic. But the pumping from Marina Drive to Corsair down Caravelle is because, and you go ahead and complete my sentence, but you're pumping it from Marina Drive to Corsair because?
Well, that's the natural flow of the water. Well, the storm water is going to go in that direction regardless. So the pump that's on the opposite end of Marina, that's in front of the apartment complex, that pump is maintained and is operated by staff when we're running it. And we don't shoot the water at high velocity. We have the ability to control it manually, the flow, and it's intermittent flow. We also had staff, including myself, that was out there at Corsair to ensure that the flow of the water was continuous. That flow of water will occur regardless of whatever we do. We can't stop the flow of water from the storm, but we do have the ability to maintain as far as minimizing the areas that do flood. And that's the whole goal of our operation. I had staff working morning and night. In the morning time after a rain, what's really important to understand is that we have a lot of landscaping in the city, and especially in O-Town area. And when, after it rains and we have heavy winds, the leaves, they blow, and they're going to stick to the gutter area because it's wet. And when they cover a storm inlet, or if they cover a storm basin, it's like having a carpet over those storm drains, and it will flood immediately. So we understood that. We've watched what has occurred in the past. We're learning from this. And every year, you know, we're going to continue to learn because every year it's not going to be the same. The intensity could be less, or the intensity of the rainfall could be more. But I can let you know that we're aware that these have occurred, and we've done our best to keep those storm drains completely clean. I made sure that we had Spectrum, our landscape contractor, with their crew out raking early in the morning, right after the storms, and raking up the leaves, making sure that, and every employee that from the yard was looking through every catch basin, and we have hundreds of catch basins, looking in, cleaning it out, making sure that the next rain it comes, we don't have anything that's going to impede the flow.
Okay, and the resident said as much, so I just wanted to clarify that, and I think they appreciate it. I think we're not done with the storms, and we'll just keep an eye on it as planned. Thank you.
Madam Mayor, I did have a comment. Obviously, this was very professionally well done, but I think we have to give credit to our city manager and her staff because she was behind the curve on this. She had the first meeting in October, the first part of October, to get these agencies together, and she had all the different agencies, the fire, lifeguards, sheriffs, and that allowed us to get ahead. And I understand there was some equipment that other cities wanted to get, but we had already made arrangements to get those. And I think it was due to the fact that we got in early and we had a long time to plan. And I want to commend the city manager and her staff.
Point well taken.
I have a question. With regard to the Guava Ironwood area, that collection area, if that floods, do we have, and we use the portable pump, do we have enough hose to pump it down to the Elder Ironwood collection area?
Well, yes, we do. And hoses are readily available. Pumps are not. So in the event that we do need that type of service, our rental company can provide additional hoses for additional links.
Well, we'd have them on site.
No, we don't, but we do have a certain amount of length of pipe on standby in our yard.
Well, I think it's pretty obvious that the city did a fine job in keeping us dry. And I'd like to mention, no one, city staff doesn't go into Leisure World. We had a thunderstorm and hailstorm also that evening. And we managed to stay high and dry as well. And it was through no fault of the staff. They did an astronomical job, just like the city staff, in keeping us protected from the water. And I'd like to thank everyone that was involved in this program for doing such a fine job, and it was good practice for what's coming in the next month or two. Thank you. This is a time for members of the public to address the council regarding any item within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the council cannot discuss or take action on any item not on the agenda unless authorized by law. Matters not on the agenda may, at the council's discretion, be referred to the city manager and placed on a future agenda. Those members wishing to speak are asked to come forward to the microphone, state their name for the record, and all speakers will be limited to a period of 5 minutes. And any documents that you have for review, please pass them to the city clerk for distribution. Thank you. And Seth Eaker.
Thank you, Mayor. It's a pleasure to be before you again. Happy New Year and congratulations. Seth Eaker, resident Seal Beach. I did actually have a question for the OCFA Division 1 Jurisdiction AED process. I know at least one business I'm associated with has an AED on private property, and we would love to register that AED so that it can somehow show up on that map and that we can be part of the public deployment, because that would be terrific. So maybe we can talk about that, because that sounds like a great way to help save lives. Number two, I just wanted to give the council and residents a report. You know, still for that final period at the end of the sentence for the centennial is our commemorative guidebook. We do have it complete. It is printed and we are shipping. We just have to get it to the locations for disbursement. So the council and staff knows. Special thanks to Patrick Gallegos and Tina Knapp, who continue to work closely with the remnants of our team to make sure that we finish up on that promise. So thank you. I also wanted to acknowledge the Lions Club for two things. Number one, the Melvin Jones Fellowship Awards Dinner was last Saturday night at Knott's Berry Farm. It was my honor and humble privilege to be one of the honorees, along with Marcia Haley, Ellen Lieber, Les Shobe, Shardy Lang, Newt Freeholm, Tim Kelsey, our recreation manager, Mike Gibbons, Ryan Ziegenbusch, and Laura Ellsworth. And this is the highest honor that can be bestowed upon a member of Lionism. And it's pretty amazing that 10 out of the 24 awardees for the southern half of California are from Seal Beach. So I'd like to give them all a round of applause. Also with that, Lions International produces a magazine, and it's pretty remarkable to see California Dreamin' with 300 lions almost in a picture on our beach with our pier there. And I can tell you that this has generated phone calls, emails, and inquiries from our club from literally all over the nation and the world. And Seal Beach is known for its friendliness, and I guess I'm here to say we're known for our service, too. And special shout-out to the Lions Against Graffiti program, which is highlighted here and is a great example of a joint public-private venture. So the Lions would like to really thank the city, the police department, the lifeguards who also help us at the jetty for keeping us aware of all of that information, and, of course, public works and planning. So thank you to all. Then, in addition, I wanted to give the city a brief update. Run Seal Beach, very exciting. Coming up on April 9th, registration is open. We're over 1,000 runners already, which is great. Sponsorship is currently open. We're doing some final tweaking of the website right now to update some changes. So please go to runsealbeach.com to do individual registrations and also team registrations, which we're going to be wrapping up with a new electronic process rather than printing a form and then sending it in. I've been getting a lot of communication on that right now, and please continue to use Seal Beach or run SealBeachPR@gmail.com, but we're going to have some domain emails coming up shortly. Also, a special thanks to Joe Dawson and Studio Cafe for her generous inclusion of Run Seal Beach, and Leif for the King and Queen of Hearts event, which is coming up on February 19th. And we have a number of our residents in that. Chief Joe is a former candidate, and the Polar Plunge was amazing. We had about 130, right, Chief? And Chief Joe Bailey, thank you for the lifeguard support. And man, those fireboats spraying water were awesome. It was great for the plungers and for those who bought plunge protection. It raised over $4,000 for Leif and was fantastic. And special thanks to Griffin's Grill for their donation of hamburgers, the lines, and of course Chief Joe for spearheading that effort with the Police Foundation and Leif. And that concludes all the great news I have for Council and the public. Thank you.
The Lions Club is such a wonderful organization. I know I'm not supposed to say anything, but I don't know that you ever take a breath from one event to another. And thank you all so much for everything that you do for the community.
Good evening. Happy New Year. My name is Mike Varekia from Old Town. I understand there's a negative vibe about the city manager again. I'm here to give her my support. Speaking from my own personal interaction with her, she's been nothing more than accommodating to me over the years, whether it be through email or seeing her on the street. But I see her hitting the pavement constantly. It's not like she's sitting in her office sipping coffee all day and being at the coffee chats. More than accommodating, the people who look at her at a negative light are probably the people who don't come to the coffee chats, because I understand there's a lot of people who don't even come, and if you're not going to make your voice heard or participate in the city interaction with things, you shouldn't complain about any of the city officials, because they make themselves more than accommodating from my viewpoint. I don't know any other cities that where you can just email the city manager or go to a coffee shop and sit there and talk to her for as long as you want to. So I'm just here to give my support, and anybody who has a negative vibe about it, maybe they need to come out and participate in the city functions and the city events and get to know Ms. Ingram, because she's very accommodating and she has my vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Patty Campbell, College Park East. I'm going to take a different tack. On December 14th, I went to the oral communications of the closed session of the last council meeting of the year. I went there to inform the council of some onerous conditions at the city regarding treatment of our employees. We've had a lot of employees leave, some because of awful treatment by our two department heads, others saw the writing on the wall and secured other jobs and left. In my comments, I asked for an anonymous survey be done of our employees and also exit interviews of those employees that have left to find out just what's going on here. You have declined to do that. Jill, I have to lay all this at your feet as you're the city manager. You set the tone. You don't speak with people you don't like. You simply ignore them. You did that with Linda Devine for at least a good year. She got so fed up with it that she left. Had you been civil to her, she would have completed her term. Jim Basham and Vicki Beatley have created hostile work environments. Some employees are being treated very badly in an effort to get them to leave. In finance, the stress from Vicki was so harsh that one employee had to be taken to the hospital by other city employees fearing she was having a heart attack. In the end, she and another finance employee just left. They couldn't take it anymore. In Public Works, a 31-year employee who long ago proved her worth to the city. She was the executive assistant to both the Public Works Director, the Planning Director, and also worked the counter, and who could single-handedly run all of upstairs, was treated so poorly, she very unhappily left. What a way to end a 31 career with a city you love. By the way, we had an employee who died some years back, Bob Eagle, who used to be Santa Claus during the holidays. This 31-year employee would go with Bob to all the Christmas activities as Mrs. Santa Claus. All the residents know and love her. As one resident said to me when she heard what happened, "You mean they forced out Mrs. Santa Claus?" So, Jim, a relative newcomer to this city, will forever be known as the guy who forced out Mrs. Santa Claus. Now, Jim, in the yard, you have taken away duties and shortened hours to get some employees to leave. You know, Jim and Vicky, if you don't like people's job performance, tell them what they're doing wrong so they can fix it. Firing people is one thing, but forcing them out by being cruel, demeaning, and humiliating to them so that they will leave is something else. That invites lawsuits and workplace violence. It is my understanding that there are two hostile workplace claims and one workman's comp claim against Jim Basham. I have been told all this firsthand. But this is not about employee competence. It's about perceived loyalty. And this is what starts with Jill. She demands her top people take an oath of loyalty to her. Loyal to her first, loyal to the city second. Employees who are seen as loyal to the city first get forced out. And longtime dedicated employees are very loyal to the city. Hence, their departure. Our remaining employees are fearful for their jobs, and with good reason. Morale is very low. You want loyalty? You get loyalty by showing leadership and taking care of your people. It must be earned. You don't get it through fear. Jill, you didn't like it when Carmony treated you poorly, and now you're doing it to others. I believe in second chances, but what has happened here is so egregious for the lives and families you have hurt that I think you need to leave Seal Beach. Never mind giving you a raise, they need to show you the door. You and your two directors know better than to treat people like that. The week before the 31-year employee left, I called her to wish her well. I've known her forever.
1 minute.
She was quite upset at what was being done to her. Next thing I heard that you told the city attorney that I made her feel uncomfortable, a common phrase of yours. So I called her back and asked her that. Had I made her feel uncomfortable? She said absolutely not, that I made her feel better. And regarding your comments to the city attorney, she said she never said that, and that she hadn't spoken with you since September. So, Jill, you lied to the city attorney. Lied to the city attorney. I really wish the council would reconsider and conduct those anonymous surveys of the employees and also exit interviews of those who have left. It would really open your eyes to what is going on here. At the end of my comments last December 14th, I stated that if the council votes to keep Jill, then you all are guilty of employee abuse and have become part of the problem because you will be voting to allow it to continue. Our employees are not expendable and deserve much, much better.
Good evening, City Council, City Staff, Robert Goldberg. I want to echo some of the comments that were just made. On tonight's agenda, for those in the audience, there is a proposal to give the city manager an $11,000 merit raise. This is about a 4.7% increase of her gross pay. This is on top of a cost of living increase that she got in July. Presumably, merit raises have to be earned. I know you all had a consultant come in and review her performance, but I don't know whether that consultant really reviewed some of the things that happened over the past year. In January, myself and this, at least 50 or 60 people here came and complained to you or pleaded with you regarding a vacation that she took with a contractor back in August. That contractor, the same month she took that vacation, she had signed a renewing a retainer agreement for that contractor for $2,000, public relations contractor for $2,000 a month. and also signed a retainer for that that person's close business associate for another $3,000 a month. She could have, before she planned this trip, she could have asked the city attorney, hey, city attorney, what do you think about me going to Alaska with this contractor who I've befriended over the last year? She didn't ask. She had no intention of revealing that. It was revealed because of various reasons regarding payments to this contractor. We saw a photograph of her with the contractor on the contractor's Facebook page. At the time, what I said, and I still say, that her taking that trip without consulting the city attorney is just an extreme example of poor judgment. And poor judgment in a city manager is an unacceptable liability for the city. Having said that, to now have to come talk to you about a merit raise is very upsetting, is very dismaying. By considering this, you're really you're discounting, dismissing all the concerns that were raised to you in January that really weren't properly addressed. Ms. Ingram, even in January when this was presented, she wasn't apologetic. She wasn't remorseful. All those in attendance that I spoke to agreed that she was nothing but defiant. And I'm going to read a quote of what she actually said in response. This was a prepared statement. She had over 10 days to prepare a written statement. And in her written statement, she said, "I recognize how the optics may appear to some from a public perspective. However, is there anything improper, inappropriate, illegal, immoral, unethical, or otherwise as a result of this trip? No, absolutely not." So this is someone that just can't recognize right from wrong. She has poor judgment. She has weak ethics. And if you retain her, you retain her at her own liability. But come on, don't give her a merit raise. I mean, she is basically unemployable anywhere else. 2 days after the hearing in January, this article was published in the Orange County Register with a photograph of her on a vacation with a consultant. If she were to seek a job anywhere else, any due diligence would reveal this, and nobody would consider her. Everyone I've spoken to regarding this, they're just in disbelief.
1 minute.
About this whole matter. Regarding morale, I've had two people contact me anonymously about morale, echoing what Patty has said. It's very disturbing. I'm not going to repeat details, but again, morale is a whole other issue that's of concern, which unfortunately you guys didn't pursue. Finally, real quick on the storm drains, I have to disagree with the community director. The water that you're pumping from the south side of Marina into Bridgeport does not normally flow into Bridgeport. That is a different watershed. And what you're doing is you're moving water from the San Gabriel River shed there into the watershed to the north. And we flooded last December in Bridgeport, and adding water from a different watershed is nothing but reckless. When we flood and houses and cars are damaged, there will be hell to pay by my neighbors. Thank you very much.
Anyone else?
Joyce Parquet, Old Town Seal Beach. Congratulations, Sandra. And we're back at it again. 1 year ago, I stood here and said it was time for her to go because of the dear neighbor, which now, Mayor Deaton, acknowledged that she did help prepare for the utility tax plan. And I said at that time that was taking taxpayers' money from us because she did. She took 66,000, and I never got responses from a lot of questions I asked. And we never got the election code. Election code said that we could have 10 days before to dispute it and 5 days after. So I asked that she resign then because there's no transparency in her government. I also used to have meetings with her, personal meetings with her and Vicky. And every time I asked something or questioned something, well, who said that? I said, well, I'm not going to say who said that. That's like the witness program over at the DA's office, the snitch. I'm not going to answer that. So I gave up. I gave up. But now I went upstairs and I said, I want to talk to Karen Walton. Oh, she's not here anymore. She resigned. I saw her crying with you out there that day. Crying. And I didn't know it at the time that she had put her on the list to get out. The mayor. I'm not the mayor. The city manager. I didn't know it at the time. But that lady had been here a long time. That lady knew everybody in Old Town. She walked this town every lunch period for a whole hour, walking around, crying. I wanted to go over, but my husband said, no, leave him alone. So now, you're right. She does not need to be here. She is not ethical. So, in the meantime, I got all of her charge cards for the city for the past year. Charge cards. I'm after more. I want to send them to Howard Jarvis. So on those charge cards, we had a lot of food going out. We paid for a lot of food. I would like to know who. We had a lot of meetings on the boathouse on the bay, and that was one of the meetings that her friend wanted to have a drink looking at the sunset go down. A lot of boathouse meetings on the bay, drinking up, having fun. It's all here. Page after page after page, and trips, a lot of trips. So I'm going to come back and request where those trips were. Where were those trips? Councilwoman Deeding, Councilwoman Deeding, where were those trips? A lot of trips that I haven't been able to go over yet. But this is crazy. This is taxpayers' money when we got alleys that need to be fixed. We should have had a berm down there instead of dirt. This is crazy, all this money going out. Waltz Wharf. Boathouse on the Bay. Waltz Wharf. Oh, where is it? Oh, the fortune cookie. I mean, do you go up there with her? Councilman Deeding? Councilwoman Deeding, do you go up there with her? Who goes up there with her? I mean, you're talking tons of money.
1 minute.
Tons of money. It could have been spent preventing the first storm that knocked the berm down. Tons of money that she has been spending. So now I'm getting the other account, other credit cards. But, yeah, she needs to go. She's not ethical. She's not honest. I said this a year ago. I had meetings with her. Didn't come anywhere. She wanted me to be the snitch of town. I'm not the snitch. I'm the person who comes down here and tells the truth. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, moving on. City Attorney's report.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of the council, prior to the meeting this evening, the council met in closed session regarding the two items on the posted agenda and took no reportable action.
Thank you. City Manager's report.
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. I have a couple items tonight. First of all, we have a new part-time employee that's with us here tonight, a new part-time executive assistant in the city clerk's office. So I'd like to turn it over to our new city clerk, Robin Roberts, to introduce Winnie Bell. Robin?
Thank you, City Manager Ingram. It's my pleasure to bring Winnie Bell to the Seal Beach team. She'll be serving as the executive part-time assistant in the city clerk's office, which is a very busy office. She's worked in municipal record for approximately 10 years, and she has 8 years of experience in the city clerk's office, mainly doing Public Records Act requests, city records and retention programs, as well as working with the filings for FTPC and Form 700. So, Winnie, thank you so much, and welcome aboard.
Second item I have tonight, if Seth's still here, he stole a little bit of my thunder, but I would like to formally recognize Tim Kelsey. Tim, can you stand up just for a minute, please? So, Seth indicated Tim was awarded one of the Melvin Jones Fellowship Awards this Saturday night. And I think, at least what I know of, is each member that was awarded that recognition on Saturday, the Lions Club gave a $1,000 donation to Lions Club International. I think it goes without saying, this donation in Tim's honor is so well deserved. He spends countless hours in our community supporting all of our events, and as a manager, he's salaried, so he's out there on his own time, and I can tell you without a doubt those events would not happen without his support. So Tim, I want to thank you for your dedication and your devotion. You're an asset to Seal Beach. Well deserved. My final item tonight, at the December 14th council meeting, the council approved the issuance of special tax refunding bonds for the Pacific Gateway Business Center, and at that time we had estimated a savings as a result of the refinancing of those bonds. And so I'd like to ask our finance director and city treasurer, Vicki Beatley, to tell you some good news that's going to result in even more savings to the center. Vicki?
Thank you, City Manager Ingram, Mayor, members of the council. I am happy to report that we did have a very successful refunding of the Pacific Gateway Community Facilities District bonds last week on Wednesday. We were in the market. We were the only issuer in the market. We were the first issue after the first of the year. And if you may recall, last week the stock market didn't do all that well, and there was lots of volatility going on. That being said, Seal Beach's refunding issue sold very successfully. We had over 120 orders. Most of them were from the mom-and-pop type retail buyers. There was one institutional client who bought actually all of the maturities between 2021 and 2031. We were oversubscribed by 1.8 times, which means effectively that we sold more than we had. So they had to allocate to all of the buyers based upon some formula calculations. And some of the maturities were actually oversubscribed by up to 6 times. So that was very fun to watch the activity on the market. The initial projection when we came to council in December was that we would have a 9% net present value savings, which would equate to approximately $90,000 a year annually on average for all of the property tax payers in the Pacific Gateway. The final numbers, that net present value was 18%, and the savings increased to over $118,000 a year on average. The maturity of the bonds was not extended, so the final maturity remains the same. And because it's a commercial area, there is actually a small number of property owners, 10 to be exact, that will be the beneficiaries of the efforts of City of Seal Beach staff and the financial advisors. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Mayor?
Yes.
May I? Vicki, thank you again. I do not know that everyone understands that this is something that you and your staff have gone out and done on behalf of our businesses and our residents in town, not because they have requested it, but because you saw an opportunity on their behalf, and you have saved them money, not the citizens of Seal Beach at large, but individuals that own property. And I think that that is just an outstanding service to our community, so thank you.
Thank you.
That concludes my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we're at council comments. Council member Miller.
Yeah, I'm really unhappy that I'm put in this situation tonight, because last year the council policy was changed. So it puts me at a point where I have to make public comments rather than comments in closed session regarding the city manager. I just want to make it clear that since August I've received emails and phone calls and anonymous letter from about the treatment of our employees and the morale of the city employees. And I've heard and read
everything that Patty Campbell said. I've heard that from the employees. I've heard it. I've read it in documents. And I think that it's important that we understand that I've been told that many employees feel that they have to be loyal to the city manager and accept any situations dictated to them, or they would suffer the same consequences of some of the employees that have left. I won't even go into the descriptions given to me, but one of the concerns that I had is one employee in particular said they had never seen such petty cronyism and corruption. And the word corruption has rung a bell with me, which I'm going to pursue with the district attorney, because I don't know what the hell they're talking about, because I don't do investigations. And I would only say to the employees, if this council has an investigation, or the city attorney has an investigation, or the DA has an investigation, they should be forthright and be honest. And I'm not going to do the investigation. Somebody else will do it, so if it's done. That's all my comments.
Council Member Deed.
Yeah, first I'd like to say congratulations, Tim. You've worked long and hard, and we really appreciate your service, and I'm glad that you were recognized. Also, I'd like to say welcome to Winnie Bell. We've needed the help, and we appreciate your work for us. Thank you very much for coming. And then finally, I'd like to make my comments on the storm prep. Since much of Old Town has been built below sea level, I was very concerned also about the flooding. I spent the rainy days out checking on property throughout the entire area, including Bridgeport and those areas outside of my district, to be sure we did not flood. There have been years that I have had to take my forerunner and go through the water or through the alleys in order to get home. That didn't happen. And I appreciate the fact that our staff planned, they implemented their plan, and their plan worked. And that I liked, Jim, what you said tonight. We learn from each incident and plan for the next one. And we know we're getting water, but I know that you've been well prepared, and I appreciate it. So those are my only comments for now. I will address other things later. Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, thank you, and Happy New Year, everybody. Sure, it's a heavy first meeting. I just wanted to mention I did represent the city at the Southern California Association of Governments Economic Summit. Every 4 years, SCAG prepares a long-range regional transportation plan for six counties, and we're one of the six counties. And this plan balances future mobility and housing needs with economic, environmental, and public health goals. And it's an important plan for our region because it allows our project sponsors to qualify for federal funding. It was a very interesting meeting. Thank you.
Good. SCAG is a good agency. Council Member Sloan.
I have nothing at this time. I will later.
I'd like to thank everyone for coming here tonight and enjoying our first meeting of the year, and Happy New Year, and I'm sure that we will have a very successful one. We'll move on to council items. I don't believe that there are any at this time. Consent calendar. A motion to accept the consent calendar without B and D.
So moved.
Second.
All vote, please. Oh, good. 5-0. Passes. Okay, we'll go to B then. Demands on city treasury. That was yours.
Yes. I pulled this item because of on page 18 we show a total of $68,786.10 being paid associated with El Nino, and I support the effort. I think the staff's done a good job. My position is that we need to follow the resolutions and charter of the city. This item, I brought it up last time, and this warrant list substantiates what I said, that this should have been brought to the council for approval back on October 2nd or before in September. there's a requirement that any dollar amount exceeding $28,800 has to come to the council for approval. And this item did not come to the council for approval. The council finally approved this item on December 14th of last year. And I think it's necessary that we follow the procedures. If we had the same thing on something that was even more trivial, like the carnival. But it's we have a procedure, and the city manager needs to follow the procedure and bring these items to us in advance. Had this been brought to us in advance, the council may have had an opportunity to input on what they thought about maybe another pumping area or something. And again, it was all under plan back in September, and it should have come to the council then, not in December. And I'd like to, I would at least like the record to reflect that I feel that this violated resolution number 6384. Thank you.
I'm trying to remember, were there conflicts with getting it on an agenda because we were dark?
You know, as I indicated at the last council meeting, it was staff's intent under emergency conditions for preparation and our understanding that we could move forward with those efforts given the time constraints to get especially the pumps in place without the time constraints of a council meeting.
But the problem is there was no imminent emergency.
Well,
no.
I'm sorry.
There was no imminent emergency at that time. And even emergencies have to come to the council for approval, especially if they're considered a capital project. They're supposed to go out to bid, and if you don't, you're supposed to come to the council. That's a different, that's section 10 of the city charter. The point is, it's not like today we have waves coming in, we've got to get a berm built. This was planned in advance. There wasn't an imminent emergency, so.
Mayor, if I could, that's why I indicated at the last council meeting, I believe, that we did confer with the city attorney's office, and that's when the decision was made to go ahead and just bring to council at that point the expenditures to date, and then any expenditures after council approval of those expenditures at the December council meeting will bring to you at the conclusion of the storm season.
So are you saying the city attorney said not to bring it to us in October?
I'm indicating to you that it was our understanding that, as I indicated at the last council meeting, I believe that it was our understanding that we could move forward with those expenditures since we were planning for emergency conditions. After discussion with staff and with the city attorney's office is when we decided to bring it to council, since we knew what the expenditures were to date to get your approval, and then we would move forward, and after, at the conclusion of the storm season, we would come to you with the totality of the expenditures.
But the problem was there was no emergency back on October 2nd when you had
Mayor,
it.
I think there's a really important question about an interpretation of the word imminent. And one person may have one definition of what an imminent emergency is. Another person, especially from the staff perspective, has another definition of what the word imminent is. The fact is, in September and October, everybody knew this storm emergency was coming, and staff acted, as is very common in cities all over California, under an emergency procedure to prepare for the upcoming storm season. And the expenditures then, as Councilman Miller, I think, is asking for, then came before this council for approval in December. So whether December is imminent or September was imminent, there can be differences of opinion, but the procedure that staff followed in this case with the consultation of our office was very common under city's emergencies procedures, and we feel confident that the expenditures were appropriately approved.
The city charter under 1010, as an example, when we start talking about the bid process, it says that the council should be an emergency necessary for the preservation of life, health, and or property. I think we're far apart from that situation. So
I guess
I disagree with you, Mr. Attorney.
I appreciate that, Councilman, and I think, without having the charter in front of me, question whether 1010 applies to this situation at all. But
That's why I actually referred to the resolution.
And I would just reiterate for the council's information that we were consulted in this situation. We do believe the expenditures were appropriate under an emergency planning process. And as the council has approved those expenditures already before this warrant register came before you, it seems to me the issue is moot anyway. The council's approved these expenditures now in December. Whether they should have been approved earlier than that, I think, is all sort of, to quote a former president, depends on your definition of is or imminent or whatever the issue is. In staff's pre-planning capacity, they felt that the emergency was imminent at that time.
Well, and I concur. I defy anyone to tell us when El Nino is going to hit. We've been hearing about it all spring, summer, fall. No one knew when it was going to come. You have to get ready at some point. And you can't wait until the first rainfall.
Well, absolutely. But the point was, we had a bid proposal on October 2nd. We had a council meeting on October 12th. We could have discussed it right then. That's my point. I mean, why have resolutions and rules if you're not going to follow them? We did the same thing for the ADA curb. The council came in 6 months after the fact and called it an emergency and approved it. I mean, we have to get this house in order where we do the rules and follow them.
Well, I think we do follow the rules.
I don't, but okay.
Okay. Now, how do I proceed, City Attorney? Do I
take a motion on this item?
Take a motion to approve?
I make a motion to approve.
Second?
Second.
Okay, please vote. Okay, 5-0 passes. Okay, the second amendment to the city manager's employment agreement, item D. Councilman Miller.
Yeah, I have, again, I've been put in a position I would prefer not to be in. But, again, the rules were changed last year. On this item, this is the package I provided to the consultant on the city manager's performance. It's quite thick, and, of course, I know you didn't see it, but it was for July 4, 2014 through November 2015, and there I identified cases of poor judgment, lack of transparency, delays in presenting and completing projects, failure to follow policies and procedures, treating employees poorly, creating morale issues, and efforts to discredit me. And therefore, I'm opposed to this agenda item, and I would even recommend that the council consider terminating the employment of the city manager.
Would you like to make a motion?
That would be a substitute motion.
Well, there's no motion on the floor, so...
Oh, okay, then that's a motion.
The motion is to terminate?
What's your motion?
The motion is to terminate the city manager effective now.
Is there a second? Motion dies for lack of a second. Do we have another motion? Okay.
I would like to move approval on this, and I'd like you to get a second, and then I'd like to address it, please.
Second.
First of all, I'd like to directly address the fact that any changes in procedures that we had did not put Councilman Miller in a difficult situation. That it prohibits him from calling for a evaluation of the city manager without asking for it at the dais and getting a second, and we in fact had the evaluation. Then I would like to also say that, yes, he did give a packet to the consultant, which she reviewed and would not let any of us see, so we don't really know what's in there. But I did ask her if there was anything of substance, and I was told absolutely nothing of substance was in that. So unless the consultant also is somehow in cahoots with all this, I don't know how that came out. So then there was the comment tonight that we were dismissing everything presented in January. And I would like to make the statement that no one has ever dismissed anything or put anything under the rug or not done anything except fully look at every bit of evidence that has ever brought here, whether through oral testimony, email, telephone calls, or whatever they might be. First, I would like to say that as soon as the vacation came to light, that our attorney took a look at it thoroughly. That wasn't good enough. The Sun newspaper came in and looked at it thoroughly. That wasn't good enough. It went to the DA. Evidently, the DA can't do the job either, because every single person came back and said, there is nothing there. So not one member of this council has ever swept anything under the rug or dismissed anything whatsoever. So it's time for us to get back to the taxpayers' business and move on. So now I have something that I would like to, that I have typed up, that I'd like to read. I would like to ask that the city clerk put it in the record, please. I am personally voting to give our city manager, Jill Ingram, a merit raise this evening, because a merit raise is more than warranted with how well our city has been run under her leadership for the last 5 years. For the past year, I have carefully evaluated every email, every phone call, every communication that I have received about City Hall and the delivery of city services, and it is clear that she has earned this merit raise of 3.5%. Another figure was thrown out tonight. That's not the number that I've been told we're approving. Because our city manager has hired, trained, and mentored a team of bright professionals, the delivery of city services has never been higher. Whether we are looking at balancing a budget, living within our means, reforming our pension system, or preparing for El Nino, this city manager has done an exemplary job. She has not received a merit pay increase since 2013, and this well-deserved merit raise will place her in the middle of her peers at other beach cities of similar size and budget, but still below what we paid her predecessor 5 years ago. She's still making less. I am voting for this merit raise because Ms. Ingram has been a devoted employee who has made Seal Beach a better place to be. Thank you.
Madam Mayor?
Yes.
Please make a quick statement. I just want to say I'm kind of new to the council, and that's not an excuse here, but the evaluation process is very new to me. We had a very good meeting with the consultant, I thought, one-on-one as a group, and I thought it was very productive. Goals were set, and I think 6 months would be a good time to reevaluate that, and that's my position on that. Thank you.
I'd just like to say that we have a city that has a balanced budget. We live within our means. We have adequate reserves. We have people that love Seal Beach, that want to be in Seal Beach. We have employees who are dedicated and love their job. And I'm convinced that our city manager is a big part of that. I proudly am going to vote for her merit increase.
I don't want to belabor the point, but many of you know that I've been in this business a long time, and I've worked for many city managers. I think I may have even said this once before. Jill has done such a good job. I am so glad that she's here. I've been in cities where you don't want to be, worked for city managers you do not even want to know. And she has surrounded herself with more than competent people to get the jobs done that need to be done. For what I see, I think she's doing a fantastic job. She keeps me in line because I want to spend money, and she lets me know the real truth. And she's done a fine job. And unless one of us wins the lottery this weekend, our CIP budget, or program rather, will never be funded ever in its life, because we have more things that we need than we have. And Jill has never let us go overboard. She's always kept us in line, at least from the time I've been here. And I support her totally, as you may have guessed by my comments. Anyone want to make a motion?
Call for the question.
I think I already
I have a motion
and David seconded it.
Right, you did.
Call for the question. Okay, please vote. 3 ayes, 1 abstention, 1 no. Let's do it again. We have a mistake.
I think we don't. I think
names,
we. I think
the names,
we
names, are,
names are wrong.
Someone abstained.
Okay. I abstained.
No. Okay.
Do you want to do a roll call?
Let the record reflect that Councilmember Verapapa was the abstention, and Councilmember Sloan was a vote in favor, along with Mayor Masalava and Councilmember Deaton.
Right.
And Councilmember Miller voted no. No, 3-1-1.
Did you have a voice vote?
He clarified.
We just have we have a labeling issue on our dais.
Okay. I have a note here for PowerPoint, but we already had that, didn't we?
For item G?
Yes. Is that a separate item?
Yeah, it's on the next item. Unfinished business on the CIP update.
Okay, go ahead.
So with this item, item G, unfinished continued business, the CIP quarterly workshop, as the council will recall, staff presented this item on December 14th, and it was the consensus of the council to continue this item to tonight's meeting so that you would have some time to review that PowerPoint presentation from the last meeting so that we could have some discussion tonight. So with that, I'll turn it over to our Community Development Director, Jim Basham, and Deputy Public Works Director, Michael Ho, for tonight's presentation. Jim?
Thank you. Madam Mayor, members of the City Council, just briefly, the PowerPoint presentation that was presented to City Council in December of 2015, we identified a number of projects that we need to move forward on and those that we could postpone based upon their timing and their urgency. In the presentation, we've identified a number of projects that are already in design and already under construction. Staff is informing City Council that we're still moving forward with those projects. Those projects were approved already by City Council. They were also funded and approved, and the funds have been encumbered in that regard. Staff would ask that the City Council receive and file the capital improvement project, the program, and the projects that are still moving forward. And that concludes staff's presentation. We'll be more than happy to answer any questions.
Questions at the staff?
Yeah, I have questions. I've gone through each one of the slides, but I also, it said that one, I think the staff was asking us to approve the recommendation of the last meeting, and there was no recommendation at the last meeting. The minutes don't reflect the recommendation, and I went through the audio, and I don't remember a recommendation. In fact, I think we stopped short of that. But I would like to go through some of these since I've taken the trouble to go through them and try to figure out and ask questions after reading them. Because, you know, it's kind of, you might remember we didn't receive these in advance last time. We just got them as we showed up for the meeting, which this is a complete, not a complete, but a significant change to the CIP that we approved just in June. So it's a pretty significant change. You may remember this all started back when we identified what it was going to do, what it was going to cost to do the pier. And I asked, could we do it? Do we have the money? And the answer was yes. And then I said, well, what about all the other things we need to do? And that's how this evolved, I believe. And so I have a number of questions that I've seen. I've seen numbers change significantly, and I kind of want to know why they've changed. I see a new item on there, like the Westminster water line and such as that. So I have questions about those now that I've had an opportunity to look at this.
Should we go through that right now?
It's at the pleasure of the council.
Okay. Well, go ahead.
Okay. Can I just make a suggestion that we go page by page, I guess? And
page
that we get
by
a,
page.
I think that's the best thing, best idea.
Back and forth every time. Right. Some
maybe just start with the high priorities, Jim, and work through them. Okay.
And I personally had no questions on the first one, so my questions come on the water. Anybody else have questions on that one?
Not on the first one.
On page four is the first one. I don't have any questions on page four.
No comment.
Page five, I have questions.
Okay.
First of all, we have a new item called the Westminster Avenue Waterline Replacement. That wasn't in the CIP in July. Have we had failures on that water line? It wasn't in the master plan for the water either in 2013.
Correct. In the 2013 water master plan, it just had general statements saying replace water lines as needed. So historically, Westminster Avenue, we have had some breaks on that line, and the repairs were costly. I believe it was about 3 to 4 years ago we had a larger break on Westminster near Apollo. And since the upcoming project of repaving Westminster Avenue, it's a good time to replace the old line, which is almost 60 years old.
How?
Almost 60 years old on Westminster Avenue. And we do have a grant to repave all of Westminster in that same location. So typically, the request for $2.8 million to replace the Westminster waterline, we would like to do that prior to repaving the street.
Is that any different than the water line that goes up Seal Beach Boulevard? I mean, it's probably 60 years old, too.
I don't know the age of that one, but Seal Beach Boulevard, we haven't had any breaks within the rough time frame, about 3 to 4 years.
How many breaks have we actually had in this line?
I've been here roughly a little over 8 years, and I've seen one break, which was a large one.
I guess I just look at it and say $30 million is a lot of money. And as I remember the last meeting, we said there was a backup supply. If that broke again, it's not like we would go without water. We'd just have to repair it.
$2.8 million, correct, for Westminster Waterline.
Okay, $2.8 million. It just seems like it's, in the big picture, it seems like it's not a high priority, but you're the engineer. And I understand you're doing a street, and everybody hates the idea of doing a street and then digging it up shortly thereafter. How many years are we away from actually doing it if we wait and do it in a timely manner? I noticed that other line was like 2019, the one going up Seal Beach Boulevard, which is a comparable, as I read the report, it's a comparable type of pipe.
Material, correct.
Yeah. And I think it was due in 2019.
For Seal Beach Boulevard, I don't have the water master plan.
Well,
correct, 2019.
I have a question to piggyback on that. I don't think that these priority items are asking to be done right now. I think that the only ones that you're asking for are the ones that are already in design. Am I correct?
Correct, but we place these as high priority, and we feel that these projects should
be identified. They're just being identified, but they're not being said, you know, that we have to do them right now.
The priority says it'll be done in the next 2 years.
0 to 2 years, and plus with the repaving coming up, we'd like this specific project to be
done. That means it'll be done this year. I think you have to spend the money, don't you, for the street?
For the street, we're looking into that, but we believe that we can award that project sometime early next year for the grant. Requirements.
So, Madam Mayor, if I can just interject in regards to what the council member was referring to, the answer is yes. What staff is asking for basically is to reconfirm that we're moving forward with the CIP items that are identified in the asterisk. Those are the ones we reconfirm in that those have already been approved, they've been encumbered with the funds from previous year, and those are the ones that are moving forward. As we get closer to a number of these that we've identified and disclosed to City Council under high priority, we'll be bringing those to you with a better understanding as to what those funding mechanisms are and the urgency as it relates to those individual program items under the urgency. If you may recall, one of the reasons why we even presented this comprehensive overview of the CIP program is because of the issue relating to the pier. So it started with that process where there was a tremendous amount of opportunity to incur a certain amount of funds in order to do improvements on the pier relating to the infrastructure, but also for the surface portion of the pier relating to a long-term tenant. So at that time, we identified for you some urgent need in regards to how you wish to spend some of the funding. But before we do that, let's understand comprehensively as it relates to the community as a whole what other projects are necessary for us to look at and determine what's best suited for the needs of the community. So one of the funding high priorities that you're aware of from the last presentation is we need to move forward with replacement of the fire line on the pier. That entire line is corroded. In the past 6 weeks, we've replaced portions of that line already and spent thousands. We had to do it because it was urgent. It was leaking. We can't have a fire line that fails to meet the compression requirements in order to put out a fire. So we've identified for City Council $1.9 million that are necessary for us to make urgent repairs to the pier. So $900,000 is coming from water. $1 million has to come from general fund. So that was identified for you, and that's part of what staff is asking that we need to continue and move forward with that immediately to make those emergency repairs. The line items that we've identified that are by asterisk, we'll continue to move forward with those projects. They've already been encumbered and moving. These additional projects that are being identified, of course, there are a lot of them, but we will be bringing those to you when we have more of a better understanding of the high priority of those items, with better understanding for City Council as they come line by line. Otherwise, you're going to be completely submerged, if you will, with the number of projects that are before you. That was not the intent. It was to give you a better picture overall where your funding needs to come, the approximate timeline for which we need to strategize to get these projects approved. That was the purpose.
Madam Mayor, may I suggest that in order to stay within a time limit tonight, that what we do is go ahead and decide whether or not to move on with the projects that are in design and focus the discussion on the pier, since this is the reason we did this, so that we can decide what do we want to do with the pier and take it a piece at a time, and then move the large scope of all of the projects perhaps to goal setting meeting. I think it's too much to do all in one night, and certainly, especially going back and forth. And
my point is that we don't have the $3 million right now to do the project, so we're going to either have to borrow it or...
Well, that's why
it's a big,
the director said he has to bring back the funding mechanisms and a number of things, which I think he could be prepared to do at our goal setting.
Yeah, because I follow this type of resource fund better, and I can see... Based on what I see here, I see contradictions with what I've read here already. So it takes another time to feed that back again. But, you know, like some of these projects went up 400%, and I kind of wonder why. I mean, your answer to you was something about the latest requirements for hiring people. And at OCTA, I know we're only escalating at 2% or 3% a year on our labor costs. So it's...
I think
that's significant.
It's possible that the previous CIPs weren't reflective of actual costs, and they are now. So.
Well, some of these went up 400%.
But this isn't going to replace our CIP. This is just to give us an idea of how to move forward with the pier, and then we can get into the CIP at the CIP time, which is not too far away, you know, and we can give our input in the goal session on the CIP to help the engineer with the CIP. So I think to try and do this all tonight is over our scope, and it would be my recommendation that we, with the more thorough understanding of where we are globally, what do we want to do with the pier and stay focused on that and move the other stuff.
I would agree. I think it's going to be a long night if we don't.
It'll be into tomorrow.
Yeah.
Did you bring your sleeping bag?
No.
All right, so should I make a motion that way? Okay, I'd like to make a motion that we give the direction to the staff to move ahead with the projects in design, and that we would give direction tonight on where we want to go with the pier. We've got to get that fence down and move ahead, and if we just keep going around and around on projects, we'll never get there, and then move it to the goal setting to go more line by line and prioritize.
Is there a second?
Yeah, I would second that, but I want to ask a question. To me, we have to go to page 32. I guess that's what you're saying, Elrie. And if I understand Vicki correctly, we have the money to at least start attacking the pier?
That's correct, Councilmember Miller. So if we could, we have a motion and a second. If I could call the question on that, then we can move on to what can we afford to do with the pier.
I've seconded it.
Okay. Yes. Call for the question.
Yeah. Call for the question.
Second.
Please vote. 5-0.
Okay, so now do we want to move on to what to do with the pier?
I guess 32 is is that not the focus point, Jim?
That
and maybe 7.
So page 7 are the mandatory repairs that are necessary, and that's to replace the fire line and also the piles that are below the water surface. We need to make some repairs for those, and that's another $900,000. And then there's $100,000 that relates to some structural repairs such as bracing and cross bracing and just some surface repairs. That's where you get the 1.9. Those we're asking for to do right now.
That doesn't include a new decking or anything like that.
No, it does not.
That leaves the old building there?
That leaves everything else that's on the surface.
Is this the piles that were burnt by fire?
No, these are just caused by Hurricane Marie last year.
Question, does that leave the fence up and the pier closed off to the people?
Well, that could be a decision of City Council if you want the fence to be removed. The end of the pier does need to be cleaned. For a while, it's been unmaintained in that regard, so there's a lot of pigeon waste, if you will. So we do
what would it cost to take the building down and take the fence down, give the people back their pier, make it, safe?
That would be approximately another $1.5 million.
You
that show on page 32.
You do remember that we were concerned about if we took the building down to be able to put a building back up?
Yes, but you know what? Almost the entire time I've been on this council, that pier has been fenced off. 5 years. That is much less of a concern to me than...
Okay. I just wanted to mention that.
I know. No, I'm very well aware of it. But I think if we get a person that wants to put a restaurant up, we can deal with that problem then.
Is that the 1.59 million?
Yes, that's pier demolition, which includes the building with an open deck.
And gives us the other things, the structure improvement and the fire line and decking.
No, this is an addition.
This is an addition.
Oh.
1.9 plus 1.5.
What is it we have to do beyond the mandatory then again?
Well,
demo the building and open the deck.
Well, that's up to City Council. Remember, these are options. So
$2.5 million, is that what we're looking at to take the building down and fix the structure of the piers and open it up so the citizens of Steel Beach can have their pier?
It's approximately, I believe it's 3.4.
3.5.
No. See, I'm never good at that.
it's approximate figures.
1.9 plus 1.5.
How much money do we have now? Just 900,000?
3.4.
Well, yes. Well, we have 900,000.
We also already have the decking set aside. We have the 300 for the decking set
aside. Well, we have some of the money set aside.
So how much is funded and how much is unfunded?
So if you look on page 7, we have water, and that's 450,000. Unfunded water is an additional 450,000 if it's up to City Council. Unfunded amount that has to come from general fund is $1 million. So that's $1.9 million for mandatory repairs to the pier.
And then $1.5 to take the building down. And make the repairs.
Redeck it.
It's unfortunate, but the majority of the funding mechanism will have to come from general fund.
Almost $3.6 million.
It's a priority. We can't turn our back on the pier any longer.
I think we need to concentrate on that because, let's face it, the pier is an icon for the city of Steel Beach, and not only for people who live here, but for visitors also. And I think we need to put on our creative hats and make it happen.
I agree
too.
Yeah, I think we should bite the bullet.
So what are we asking? What are we asking to allocate? 3.6 million?
Well, let us come back.
Jim, are you stuttering?
So if it is the wishes of City Council for us to do the mandatory as well as option one, let us bring back to you a staff report that identifies all these cost-light items. We will incorporate what City Council approved previous years in increments, because it's been over a number of years where you've approved increments of funding mechanism already. Let us put that all together for you. If that is the wishes, if City Council would like for us to move forward, bring back to us staff the mandatory repairs plus option one.
Yes.
Let us to formalize it for you so you have something better.
All right, I'll make a motion that we go ahead and ask staff to bring back for consideration the pier demo building slash open deck option along with the mandatory pier repairs, please.
Yes.
Just finishing my motion.
Go ahead. I want to ask one more thing. Thinking at the end of the pier.
Can she finish her motion?
Oh, okay. I want to add to it. Go ahead.
Okay.
Amend your motion. Go ahead with your motion.
Okay, well, let me get that. Okay, so I make that motion, and then if we get a second, then you can amend it. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What I'm wondering is, at the end of that pier, can we get an estimate of, and I realize it's going to take electricity and some kind of sewage lines, can we get an estimate for a restroom out at the end of the pier? Because you know what's going to happen. The fishermen are not going to come back in, and we're going to have a mess on our pier.
Not so much now that there's nothing hiding them, right?
Well, maybe
before
you're.
When they
I don't know. You ever been on a golf course?
But not so
Let's
much.
Not talk about open. That.
Well, it's just an idea to get an estimate of what a restroom might cost.
I think that's always a good idea to get estimates.
Well, let's find out anyway.
Let's get an estimate.
Just it's an inquiry.
Okay. Does that have to be an amendment to the motion?
Well, I just thought while you were doing the analysis, you could do it at the same
time.
We could
just ask
if the maker accepts.
Yes, that's fine. Please add an estimate of what it would cost to put a restroom out there.
Okay, seconds accepts that. Okay, let's vote.
And
we do have the money, Vicki. Okay.
Jim, do you have an estimate on the time it would take us to get this item back to council? These two meetings?
Can we do it in February, please? Okay, I just want to double-check numbers. First meeting in February.
Yeah, because people are going to want to know what we're doing on the pier.
And Madam Mayor, and this is in addition to whatever motion you make in regards to the PowerPoint, in addition to allowing staff to proceed with those that are identified in the asterisks.
That's correct.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
What was that again now? About that sound like something new?
That was my original motion.
Okay, thank you.
We're focused on the end of the pier totally, right?
Yes, and finishing those projects they're in design with right now.
Design it and under construction.
Well, I did have one question about your top lock. Why did it go to 400,000?
Can we talk about that in?
Well, it's one of the asterisk ones, I think.
Yeah, yes. There's a study though. It's not under construction.
But it's gone from 200,000 to 400,000.
Well, maybe it's a more realistic cost.
It's only toy. I mean.
I think we should call for the question on the motion that's on the floor.
Right. Let's vote on the motion that's
on
the floor.
But I want to vote yes.
And the motion on the floor is?
The motion on the floor is to have staff come back at the first meeting in February with a staff report that includes the pier building demo option and the mandatory pier repair, as long as an estimate for putting a bathroom at the end of the pier.
Okay, please vote. Okay, 5-0.
My point was, back on the other one, was that it's still under design, you're right. So we're really not going forward, but it's changed from 200 to 400,000. I wanted to know why, but just as long as we can do that when your estimate's done.
But what are you, I don't understand.
Well, it was estimated to be at $200,000. Now it's estimated at 400,000.
Mayor, if I could.
And we haven't had any report back yet.
Jim, if you could talk about the process, even projects that are in design, how we bring them to council for approval prior to moving forward, so at that time staff or the council will get an estimate on cost before we're able to move forward.
Sure. So the projects that are in design are the projects that City Council authorized city staff to move forward. we need to identify what the cost was. So originally, just as an example of Eisenhower Park, City Council authorized $200,000. So as we go through the process of soliciting proposals from individual firms, we get a better understanding as to what's also a litany of a triggering effect, if you will, or a domino effect. And that relates to when you make public improvements relating to facilities or parks, you have to pay attention to ADA requirements. To what degree ADA requirements kick in as applicable by standard is what we negotiate, what we determine through the design process. But also in regards to Eisenhower Park is undergrounding. So when we look at the cost as it relates to undergrounding, then we also have to, there's additional costs that kick in. This is where the $200,000 additional is happening, where we're learning that it's going to cost us more than $200,000 if we do this entire project. We're looking at presenting to City Council basically three sections of that design spec, which will give you the understanding of what it would cost in order to underground as a line item cost, the understanding of what the cost would be in order to place commercial apparatus, meaning the playground equipment, another cost that would be the ADA. So with those total three costs, you would identify as to what the total cost is, but it gives you the opportunity to basically bifurcate, if you will. City Council has that ability through the recommendation of staff by option. Do you want to do the playground equipment first? In my opinion, I would recommend yes, because we have an issue relating to the commercial apparatus now. It's rusting. It's a safety hazard. That's a high priority, in my opinion, for staff and for City Council. So for sure we want to move forward with that. Can that be done under the original encumbered budget amount of $200,000? Yes, it can. But what kicks in is if we do the playground equipment, I just need clarification through a certain type of state report. It's called a CASP report, where we have to identify on the capital improvement projects, especially those improvements we make with city money, what handicap ADA requirements under Title 24 is going to kick in. That's going to let me know what happens in addition to the funds that are necessary for us to complete this project. Basically, what I provide you is what happens with every project. So every project we're going to bring back to you that you've already blessed and given us the opportunity to utilize funds, we bring back to you the understanding, now that we have this all bid out, here's what the true cost is going to occur. That's like what happened with the council chambers. The true cost was much more substantial than we actually thought. So
my only point is we originally said on this, we weren't really for the undergrounding, but you wanted to get an undergrounding estimate, and that's always supposed to be an estimate. So I get a little antsy when I see it in the budget as a dollar amount. Because, you know, I'm still one of those people wanting to underground the lines in front of McGaw School rather than along Seal Beach Boulevard. So I'm sensitive to undergrounding. So,
okay.
Did you follow that?
Okay, so just for clarification, the council, I believe, has voted to continue with the projects that are asterisked and to bring back on the pier. Am I clear? Thank you.
I just wanted to clarify that I have.
Well, maybe
thank
not.
You. I have in design was the motion. It was an asterisk in design. I saw several asterisks in the report. I just wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Okay, we have no public hearings. Unfinished continued business, we just did. New business, urgency ordinance 1650. Can we have staff report, please, City Manager?
Thank you, Mayor. I'll actually give the staff report.
Mr. Attorney.
Thank you very much. It's time to talk about pot here at the end of the meeting. as you know, the field of medical marijuana is a continuously evolving area of the law in California ever since the adoption statewide of the Compassionate Use Act and the follow-on legislation that has come from 2006 to the present time. In the most recent session of the legislature, the legislature adopted three new medical marijuana-related bills. The governor signed them in September. And without going into tremendous amount of detail, there are two new areas where the city needs to, if it intends to do so, assert its right to local control over medical marijuana-related uses. As you know, the city already prohibits commercial medical marijuana dispensaries in the city and has done so since 2008. Under these new laws, the city has the opportunity prior to March 1st of this year to adopt an ordinance that prohibits the cultivation of marijuana in the city. As you may be aware from reading news reports, cultivation businesses in California are becoming more and more prevalent in cities and areas where they are permitted. We're talking anything from a small operation to very large commercial growing operations in very large warehouses. Our office has been involved in a number of operations to shut down illegal growing operations, and in one most recently in the Rancho Cucamonga area, I believe there was a seizure of 3,500 marijuana plants from a single warehouse facility that had been set up with lights and air systems and watering systems, all without proper permitting, proper inspection, and created a tremendous public safety risk. Right now, the city does not prohibit cultivation within the city limits, and the new law says that if the city does not have in effect a prohibition locally on marijuana cultivation, then cultivation becomes subject to state regulation and could be allowed in any city that doesn't prohibit it under a state licensing scheme. So we are recommending, as the first step in complying with these newest laws, that the City Council adopt the urgency ordinance that is before you this evening, take effect immediately on a 4/5 vote, and prohibit cultivation of marijuana in the city, and that will take effect prior to the March 1st deadline. The second step of this process will be back for you in 2 weeks to hold a public hearing on a permanent normal ordinance. We'll go through the normal ordinance process as we often do when we recommend adoption of an urgency ordinance, and that one will go forward and keep this prohibition going indefinitely. Excuse me. We're also going to bring forward an ordinance that amends the city's business license code and prohibits what are called mobile medical marijuana dispensaries and delivery services, which is again becoming another business that people are conducting to address this medical marijuana system. A situation, mobile dispensaries and delivery services have, as will be detailed in your staff report next time, created a number of different law enforcement challenges because of the nature of the business. And again, those types of businesses we are permitted to regulate under the new laws, and we're recommending that the council adopt those ordinances. So you will see over the course of this meeting and two others some marijuana-related ordinances for adoption in order to comply with those new laws. The Planning Commission considered the ordinance that's before you and recommended its approval. I don't mean to promise that this is the last time you're going to hear about medical marijuana. There are a number of bills that are scheduled to be considered in the legislature in the coming year. There are, I believe, three or four initiatives that are in the title and summary process in Sacramento, and one or more of them may be on the ballot in November. It's going to be a continuing, evolving area of the law, and we'll just keep responding as we're able to do so and try to stay on top of it. So that would conclude my staff report. Be happy to answer any questions, and we're recommending that the council adopt the urgency ordinance by at least a 4/5 vote, and it will take effect immediately and prohibit the cultivation of marijuana in the city.
This also prohibits personal use only, also, I should say?
It doesn't prohibit personal use. If a qualified patient uses medical marijuana, they have the card and get a prescription, it does prohibit personal cultivation. You can't grow it in the city, whether it's a small personal use or a large commercial use. but we cannot ban the use of medical marijuana as prescribed to a qualified patient. We don't do that.
But we can ban it if it's just for personal use only.
We're banning growing from on all levels. Yeah.
Any questions? Anybody like to make a motion?
So moved.
Second? Is there a second?
Okay. Mr. Miller.
Please vote. 5-0. You've got your more than 4/5 vote.
Thank you, Mayor. And with that unanimous vote, ordinance number, urgency ordinance number 1650 takes effect immediately.
Okay. Quit growing. I'd like to adjourn the City Council meeting to January 25th at 5:30. We'll meet in closed session if it's deemed necessary. Otherwise, at 7 o'clock.